I knew him, but I didn't know him. I said, oh yeah, because even Joe Boone saw him, we were talking, and I said, this is great. So I was definitely trying to get the word out, to give the support, to get you guys out here to listen to this, and also use him as a resource as he tells us about social media and the future of Biomed. So I want to get started because I know there's some stuff afterwards. I want to make sure we give him time to do what he needs to do. So I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to you. Appreciate it, man. Take it over.
Appreciate it, sir.
I don't know if it's better to be down here than up here.
Wherever you call it.
Thank you, man. Hoping I'll trip on some cables.
Yeah, I'll try to put that board down for you.
All right. All right, guys. Social media and the future of Biomed. This is it. This is the cultural shift that we just have to face. It's happening. Everybody complains that we can't find the people. The people are out there. We just have to advertise our career field, and we have to reach out to them. Business is changing. We have to do more with less. We have to work faster. We have to be more efficient. We have to share information. This is how we're going to do it. So maybe after this talk, we can talk about what you guys do. I'd appreciate that because we're always trying to do better. So we're going to talk about a variety of platforms that Biomeds can use. These are actual screenshots of things that are live right now that I do. So none of this is hypothetical. This is real stuff that is currently going on. So if you don't use social media currently while you're doing your job, maybe you might want to start, because there's things that are posted online that might make your job a wee bit easier. All right? So let's start this right out. Who is this guy? Well, I'm an 18-year biomed. I've done 9.5 years in the military. I've been a biomed through war, biomed through peace, you know, you name it, I've kind of done it. And I've been a civilian for, you know, 9 years now. So 6 years in Charleston, 2.5 years in Houston. I've been at Methodist Hospital and then Memorial Hermann right after that. Excellent experiences, both of them. And now, FOBI snagged me, and now I'm the Vice President of Business Development over at FOBI. And this speech that you're about to hear was written over the last year. So when I talk about things like contracts and finding jobs and stuff, guys, I was thinking this as a senior level technician. So here it is, I'm actually doing it. Every single day, I'm dealing with contracts every single day, biomeds out there that are looking for new opportunities. It's already happening, and I was only dreaming of it when I wrote this. So let's do this. So I had an excellent military career. I had a lot of excellent mentors, and it's funny because, you know, we're a small career field and a lot of these guys are still out there. You know, like Tim, you know, I worked with a bunch of Army guys, and you know, they're still out here floating around with us, and I love it because, you know, we have that camaraderie and that history together, right? And then my military career tragically ended one day when my lung collapsed. So you never know what's gonna happen, right? So that's why it's always to be as versatile of a person and to expand your skill sets whenever possible. We live through it and we change, and I did. So when I became a civilian, I thought I knew a lot about biomed. Man, I'll tell you what. As a civilian, it's absolutely crazy. The learning curve was extremely steep. Learning the different levels of biomed is completely different than the military. And every single day I try to learn something new, which is how I ended up doing YouTube in the first place. So my very first YouTube video was this one here. And the reason I did this video based on line isolation monitors and line isolation systems is because there was a problem in one of my operating rooms. And the electricians that were on site, they honestly didn't know how the line isolation system worked. I had a rough idea, but you know, I want to give like a real good answer, a solid answer that's backed by something. So I did the research, and then I compiled the video and I presented it to them. And to this day, that video, which was my first one, has been one of the most successful videos. I've got professors, I've got people from places like Square D that are contacting me. I mean, it went places that I never figured it was going to go, right? It was just a video for in-house. But that shows you the power of social media. You don't know where it's going to go. So how's it going? Well, you can see I've got so far 312,000 views, and I've got roughly 6,000 subscribers. Doesn't really matter. Guys, never start YouTube thinking you're gonna get rich. Ain't gonna happen. But you know, for every dollar that I've ever made in YouTube, I give away three. Like I do giveaways, I give away shirts. Every single month I give something. I bought lunch like 6 or 7 times from my biomed shop. You know, it's just one of those things, like, I'm not in this to ever make money, man. We're here because we love what we do, and, you know, I hope that that's why you're in this career field as well, man. So, I just got back from MD Expo last week, Las Vegas. I met some real cool people out there, but over the last year, man, I have way more pictures than this. It's just what I can fit on here. I meet some of the coolest people. Biomeds are some of the coolest people you ever meet. Everybody's got a story. And these are all people that asked me for photos at the moment, and I just, you know, pulled up a bunch of them that I could. But if you ever been to some of those expos, you should go, because you never know who you're gonna run into. There's lots of opportunities out there. You're gonna meet some real cool people. Lessons I've learned. Young people rely on social media. Take a look down here. You'll see that a vast majority of my viewers are 25 to 34 years old. That's the area of people that we're trying to capture and bring into the career field. Or if they're here, we want to advertise, hey, we want you on our team, right? So social media, to young people, it's a cultural thing. You know, to older people, it's like a hobby. But to young people, it's part of their culture. They grew up with it. It's part of who they are. So we have to reach out to them and break through to them in order to bring them into our world, which is Biomed. We need to change, not them. And here's the other lesson I learned. Biomed is an international career. Guys, I have had letters written to me, emails from almost every country I think I could name. It's been absolutely amazing. This list actually went way down of people from different countries that have written me, islands I had to look up, I never even knew existed. It's the craziest thing. And some of these guys have real interesting stories. So here's something that I want you guys to take away with this. I do ask that everybody contribute to social media, because just because something here is done by OEMs, where does this medical equipment go when you're done with it? It goes to other countries that don't have the resources we do. They don't have contractors. They might not have parts. And there's some excellent YouTube videos of like guys over in India that are fixing stuff with like tin foil. I kid you not. And it's absolutely amazing, because they're keeping these places running. So guys, Biomed is an international career. If you come up with a solution to a problem, internationally, you could be helping people, thousands of people, guys. So that brings me to the topic of this lecture, Biomed and social media. These are actual screenshots. This one's from LinkedIn. LinkedIn is the number one tool that I use, guys. There are CEOs, there's development engineers, there's everybody you can think of that participate on LinkedIn. LinkedIn, it does have some Biomed groups. You can see over here that I'm on a few of them. But you can also see that people are advertising stuff for sale. So I don't recommend them for Biomed groups for information necessarily. I got some other options for that later. But LinkedIn is an awesome resource if you're looking for jobs, if you're looking to reach out and increase your network. LinkedIn is the tool. Watch what you say on there though, okay? They track everything. We'll talk about that later. Facebook groups. Facebook groups is a wonderful tool. Now, Facebook groups are often either regional, like the Florida Biomeds, or it could be based on your modality. So it could be x-ray engineers or something like that, anesthesia techs. So there are very specific Facebook groups, but you have to search for them. It's not the easiest thing to do, but once you find a good group, they're often very active. And I talked with Robert about HTMA, you know, increasing their footprint on Facebook groups and stuff. I think it's gonna be an awesome resource for HTMA as well, because you know, things like this event and whatnot, we can, I mean, this is an amazing turnout, to be honest. The young people here and everything, this is amazing. But if more people knew about it and, you know, you got pinged constantly, like, hey, this is coming up next week, I know we could increase our turnout even more. Discord. This is an interesting one. It's a new one, and it hasn't been around very long, maybe this year. But this is a live chat server, and it takes an invite. And once you get an invite, now you're part of the group, and you can see my group is right up here. It's the Biomed group. Well, if you have a problem, there are people that are constantly logged in. You can see the green dots. These are all people that are constantly on Discord, and when you ask a question, they will actually get a ping. So you have all these texts that are on there passively, and when it gets a ping, if you ask a question, or are there any jobs, you can see, when there's a new topic, you see that it's highlighted in white. And ones that there's no new posts are subdued. So the ones that are highlighted in white, you can go in there and see what the latest thing is, partake in the conversation. It's a pretty cool option. Mind you, we're trying to increase participation because the more people that participate, more experience can answer your questions. Everybody's familiar with MedWrench. MedWrench has been around a while, but they haven't changed very much. This might be coming up pretty soon. Two excellent sources of information are going to be your blogs, which are formed. They're in bulletin board, and then you got your forums. This is a forum. You ask a question, and eventually you will get an answer. It's not a live thing, and I don't know about you guys, but I appreciate getting an answer reasonably quick. So we're trying to change that. I'm working with the guys at MD Publishing, and hopefully, you know, we develop like an app for your phone or something for getting more immediate response. But the good thing is historically, that you do a Google search for an error code or something, it pops up a MedWrench forum. That's the good thing, is for posterity, whatever you answer or whatever question you ask, it's there for years down the road. It's a good resource. Product and OEM forums. Now, you guys are probably all familiar with this. You ask an error code or something like that, it takes you to some generic forum. It's not necessarily owned by anybody. Almost every single equipment vendor has some sort of forum where you can ask questions and whatnot. Again, it's a social media, it's a resource, it's a tool, and it only works as good as the participation. So if you're an x-ray engineer, I suggest you guys find a forum and participate. Everybody's got a story, like I keep saying, man, and the more people that participate, the more likely that we're gonna solve these problems quicker and more efficiently. Of course, YouTube. YouTube is an excellent source, and there are some other guys that are doing YouTube videos. You can see I've got a couple different ones here and here. If you guys want, I can get you a list of different guys that are doing YouTube. There's not too many. Unfortunately, it does take a lot of work, but they're an excellent source of material for either something that you ran into, a problem, new equipment. We'll get into that later, but there's so many possibilities for YouTube, and everybody's got a camera, right? It just takes a couple seconds, that's it. So YouTube is an excellent one. Social media and jobs. This is a big one, guys. Social media, especially for the young people, they will help you find jobs. Now, these are actual things where people ask me for help finding them jobs. And this person, I've got a couple others, I found them jobs within 3 days. 3 days, they said, hey man, can you help me out? I post something, look at this. I got 883 views on this one. This one over here, I got 1,157 views. Imagine 1,157 job applications. Because that's basically what it is. You've got CEOs, you've got executives, you got hiring managers, biomed directors. All these people are on LinkedIn and all of them are paying attention. You know, so just present yourself well and go out and put a post. Join up some of these groups and people will see it and you'll get amazing amounts of responses. And if anything, you'll get people in the industry that will help you out, guide you, like, hey man, you need more experience in this or whatever. Excellent tool, guys. Social media is an excellent tool for finding jobs. There is another option. You know, most people think hospital, OEM, and third party are the ways that you get employed, right? That's not necessarily the case anymore, and that's one of the main things I'm here to tell you guys. And I know, like I said, I wrote this a long time ago before I joined with FOBI. And for the last 2 weeks, I've been finding contractors. Guys, every minute of your time is worth money. So let's say you want to retire. Let's say you don't want to work 9 to 5 anymore. Right. This is an option, guys. This is a real option. I know, I've been handing out contracts all week. You know, guys that, you know, maybe want a little extra side work. You want to go on vacation? I'll tell you what, I can show you how to make a couple extra thousand. This is actually inside my house. This is the front door. And these are all boxes of stuff that people ship to me from across the United States. You know, I have a lab, you know, I do YouTube and whatnot, but I also fix stuff, man. You know? So I'm constantly always working. Alright, so contracts, guys, they're gonna be more prevalent. You're gonna see them all over the place because there's labor shortage. Some of these places are real remote locations, like in the middle of nowhere. Often they don't have a budget for biomeds. I mean, think about it, guys. We are one of the things that people cut. It's just something that we have to accept. Installation projects, you know, if there's a renovation or something, contracts. Inventory project, contracts. Recalls, incident investigations, that's a big one. PMs and repairs. Down here, guys, many OEMs are gonna change their business model. This is something I have firm belief on, especially since they're facing pressure from right to repair. So imagine, like, currently we have, I think, SurgeEquip. SurgeEquip is a trusted service center for Skytron, right? Well, I think that that's what's gonna happen. Because last year, if you guys remember, all the vendors were stretched extremely thin. Like, or they couldn't travel between state lines. That happened to all of us. So I do believe that the business model for most OEMs is gonna transition, just like it does for many other industries, like photocopiers, fax machines and stuff. Back in the day, Xerox had their own Xerox people in every single city. That's not very efficient, right? You're stretching your guys too thin and finding talent's gonna be very difficult. So what they did is they contracted it out, and now you buy a region, and that's your trusted region, okay? And I do believe that many OEM vendors are gonna start doing that. So it's gonna be an option. So maybe a third party is gonna get a leg up, especially with right to repair, and you're gonna see a lot more stuff being contracted out by a regional entity. Social media and training, core competencies. Now this is something that me and the guys over at FOBI talked about just this week, because we're expanding just like everybody's trying to expand. And how do you maintain your training standard? You try and standardize it with something like videos. You know what they're being trained on, you can get them to sign off, you know that they viewed it. So imagine this, you got somebody new coming into your shop and you have core competencies and you have a link for every video that they have to watch in an email. And when you get a new guy, you just send that email to them, right? Like, here, I want you to watch all these videos and then get back to me and we're gonna check on it. Well, that's your training, right? You document it and you're good. Core competencies, that's something that often isn't being trained in biomed, which is why we have this skill deficit. Some other core competencies. You see here, you can find videos on soldering. A lot of guys say we don't do soldering very often. Well, that's true, but when we do, you better know how to do it because you can save the day. Core competencies on test equipment. Guys, this is such a big one. I mean, think about it. You get a new person in your shop. Some shops use Fluke, some use Pronk, some use some other vendors, but how do you know how to do it? I'll tell you how. You can look at a little video and you should be reasonably competent to take that test equipment and hook it up and start using it. Something a lot of people haven't considered. And also, once equipment's installed in your installation, maybe for refresher training, because, you know, some PMs you're gonna see 6 months, some of them you won't even see that device for a year. How do you maintain? Well, if I pick up a safety analyzer or something that I've never used before, I can look up a quick video. How do you hook it up? Okay, good, I'm good. You know, nice and easy. Nice and easy is what we need in our career field, guys. Okay. NFPA 99, things like this, latest regulations, all right? Your guys should be trained on what NFPA 99 they're using and all the other regulations that you might be dealing with. This is how you do it. You capture it in a video, or there's a bunch of them already online. You just look them up. And if you guys didn't know, every 3 years, a new NFPA 99 comes out. So it's always changing, you know? We're a very dynamic career field, so things like videos can keep you up to date. You're not going away for training, it's just 5 or 10 minutes, right? Social media and training, prerequisites. So everybody has gone away for training. One of the most annoying things that you can do is the first day or two, you are just completely stuck on theory of operation or on, you know, circuit diagrams or something like that. That stuff can be done via social media with like shared videos. They don't have to be public, they could be private and they just send you the link. There's lots of options. But the fact of the matter is a lot of training can be done before you get on site. On site should be resorted to being in the laboratory or in-depth analysis of what you're working on. It shouldn't be for stuff that you can learn in a PDF. Here you can see another example of that. This is a Philips ultrasound system review. Just an overview, like your options, your menu options and stuff like that. You can learn that in a video. There's no reason to pay somebody a hotel fee and travel fee to go and do that. Item specific training. This is a big one, guys. As you transition people throughout your facility, somebody might be working on patient monitoring equipment. Well, guess what? Now they're in the OR today. this is how you get them up to date. You got PMs on a specific item like this, you have them watch a video on how to set it up, how to test it, and then you say, go free, go do it. You know, it's one of the worst things as a biomed is getting a list of PMs and you have no clue what that device is. And this is where like sharing information is gonna help us all, because if you work on a certain device and you're a subject matter expert, then it would behoove you to create some sort of training video for continuity in your department. This one here is one that I directly relate to. This is the FMS 2000, the rapid infuser. Now this one here, I had no clue. I had a work order for this. It was an emergent thing because I specialize in ORs. I had no clue what this thing was. So I watched a video on a nurse setting up the device, so I knew how it was supposed to be set up before I even set foot in the OR. Because when you set foot in the OR, all eyes are on you. And that nobody wants to be the guy that has no clue what that is. Because as soon as you do that and you already have an irritated doctor, you're in the wrong. Right? I'm not saying everybody has to know the answer, but you have to know where to find it. And the more people that contribute, the more answers we can come up with. Item-specific training. I actually did an in-depth video on the Belmont FMS, but there are excellent videos made by the company on what the device is and how to set it up. New technologies. Now this one, maybe because I'm a nerd, new technologies is the thing. I love learning about new things, and nothing explains that better than a video. Like this one here is about a Philips MRI system. And this particular MRI system, if something gets stuck inside the magnet, you can actually shut the magnet off, go remove the item, and then re-energize it. They also have another MRI that only uses, I think, 7 liters of helium. And anybody that knows anything about MRI knows that that is absolutely insane. Normally, helium is the most costly part of using MRI, and it's hard to get. But they have one that only uses 7 liters, and it's 1.5 Tesla. That's amazing. I know about it. I've never seen one in person. I know about it because of a video. So because it was shared through, I think, LinkedIn, I sat there and I did my research. And when I see a Philips engineer at one of these medical expos or something, now I've got other questions I can ask them personally, immediately. You know, I'm not completely dumbfounded when I see it at a show. I already have my questions developed. I carry a pad of paper with me everywhere, man. So if there's something I really am curious about, I try and find it on social media, usually LinkedIn. There's some excellent sources on there. Here's a product that I learned about on social media. It's called Order. Some of you guys probably have it in your hospital. Imagine a device where you connect it to a network. It sniffs out data that your devices are leaking, like its MAC address software version, things like its IP address, and it just compiles it into a nice to use interface. I've never seen this system in person. I can tell you about it because social media. Here's another one. Guys, I have this device right here. This is one of the only ones in the United States. There's only a couple of them. It's called the Smart Tank, and what a fantastic little device. Now I have it because of FOBI, but guys, when I did this video and when I did this first speech, I knew about it and I was given a presentation on it because of social media, because it was leaked out there what this device could do. I was just in awe. I wanted to see it in person. New technologies, guys. Solving problems using social media. This actually hit a lot of us last year. We couldn't find parts. You can find parts online. You know, other people might have these parts. You know, that's one of the good things about networking, but if your network isn't that big, you can use social media to find parts. They're out there. Finding third-party vendors. Here's a device that you can see. I asked, does anybody know how to do this? I had 3 replies. I got some guidance from some people. I use social media for all this stuff. That's how I can give a presentation on it. Technical support. If you have a question, I told you earlier that Discord is like a live chat. Here's something, somebody asked a question about a certain thing. They're telling about shorting certain pins and trying that out. Who knew? There's hundreds of years of experience out there, and these guys just, you have to tap that resource. You have to know where to look for it, guys. Discord, it's getting better, man. Part shortages. Last year, you guys, we had some part shortages. It was not a cool year. And it was kind of stressful for all of us. Here is one that is actually kind of hitting right now. This is a Skytron surgical table control board. Problem is microchips. There's a shortage because they're all stuck on ships off the coast of California. It's going to happen about lead acid batteries too soon, guys. I'm telling you right now. Last week at MD Expo, I talked to the guys at like Interstate and a couple other places. They're all reaching shortage levels right now. Okay, they're all in ships. There's months worth of shortage. So if you need PMs with lead acid batteries, order them now. But anyway, social media, if you need some parts, look at this. I got three people that are contacting me. Hey, we got these. Okay, thanks. In other words, I was going to be down. Who can have a surgical table down? There's not often shortages, or you don't often have extras of those. Scouting talent. So here's a big one for you guys that are hiring managers. If you can't find people to fill a position, you can post out there that, hey, I've got a position in this city. I'm looking for a Biomed 2 or a Biomed 3 in this skill set. You can find them. And people will reach out to you, especially here in Houston. Houston is just one of those meccas of medical talent. People want to move in here because if your career is going to go someplace, it's going to be here. Identifying best practices. This is one of the best uses of social media I've seen yet. There's a lot of online debates about the best way of doing business. And that's excellent because if there's one thing I've learned about my working in a bunch of different hospitals is that everybody does things differently. Everybody does something well. All right. And you see those online debates. We do this. Well, you shouldn't do that because it's not safe because of this reason. Well, you see those debates online and you make your own judgment call, but those debates are there between people that are very knowledgeable in our career field. Photographing achievements. Guys, this is such a good one. It's not only a morale booster for your people, but it also is good for your shop because you're advertising that you want people to join your team. You want people to come in, and that's how you do it, is you show some of the achievements and some of the good stuff that your people are doing. Shop organization. I came from Texas Children's today, and I'll tell you for a fact, like that place is pretty well organized. But shop organization, if you do a good job of organizing your parts and you're ISO certified or whatever, take a photo of it, share it with everybody. You know, make us all envious of you. Sharing ideas is such a good thing. If I got a problem and I say, hey, do you guys have any suggestions on how to solve this problem? I will get 100 different ideas. I guarantee it. And that's awesome. That is absolutely awesome. Staff training and promotions. If you come back from OEM training, you get a new certificate, take a photo of it and send it to your local HTMA or whatever. Get those achievements documented and share them because nothing encourages other people to advance their career than seeing somebody else do it. All right? Staff training and promotions is an excellent place to advertise the good things that your people are doing. New programs. Now, there are new programs all the time. Let's say you're building a new tower or something like that. You're going to add new x-ray techs, or you're the first building that's got, you know, a gamma knife or whatever. New programs, share it on social media. It encourages everybody to be better. Lessons from inspections. Now this one, guys, I know we haven't had too many inspections lately, but when somebody does get inspected and they're open and honest about their write-ups, it helps us all. And I have seen some really cool ideas on how they solve some of these write-ups, because not only did they get the write-up, but often people will share how they solved the problem. So, lessons from inspections, I honestly think that everybody should share. If you get written up for something, just be honest. It might be the stupidest thing in the world, but just share it because somebody else is doing it too. And we're all here just to make this place better. We're here to be better at our career field. There's some warnings on social media though. Don't get into politics, guys, especially on any of these forums. Some people like doing that, and just don't do it. Guys, we're all about togetherness. Our career field, we need to stick together. There's not very many of us. Don't burn any bridges. Don't get into politics. We don't need that, okay? And that means your thoughts on everything from vaccinations to political parties, presidents, judges, whatever. Just don't get into it, man. LinkedIn tracks everything. If you make a comment, if you like an image, if you do anything on LinkedIn, I can research it. I can see exactly who you are as a person. And I promise you, if you guys go to another entity, like you apply for a job, probably looking in on your LinkedIn profile. So if you don't agree politically with somebody and they're a radical, they might not hire you because of your choice of decisions. Okay? So all I'm saying is be as neutral as possible on these sites. LinkedIn tracks everything. So watch, there's some racy pitchers and stuff out there. Watch, like, and a lot of that stuff, because it gives me an idea of who you are as a person, and it might not be the idea you think it is, okay? And everything you say on social media can and will be used against you. And I have personally been bit by that twice. Once I had a situation with a doctor, they asked me to leave the OR room. I had propofol leaking inside a medical device, and it was alerting the limb panel. And the doctor asked me to leave, and I said, ma'am, I can't do that. She scooted the equipment 2 feet away from the patient's head and left it plugged in. And I said, ma'am, that equipment, I can't take my eyes off it. It's gotta go with me. And she said, no, you're gonna leave my OR room. And I said, no, ma'am, I'm sorry, I can't. That equipment is going with me. And she said, well, whatever, I gotta deal with this patient. I said, go ahead, I'll take care of this. And I took some sheets, we cleaned up the propofol, and I unplugged the equipment, and it went with me, and we contacted the guys at anesthesia. We had them deliver another heater, okay? Everything's resolved. Well, I had one of my Biomed 2s who's in this room with me at the moment, and when we left the room, he said, man, I don't know if I could have done that, because she was very adamant that we're gonna leave her room. I said, no, man, we are the last link in the chain. So everybody else in that room didn't care whether or not that device was still plugged in. You were the last link in the chain. So if I walked away, that was it. It was gonna stay in that room, and for the next year of your life, you might have been chasing this device, which was randomly, it could have caught on fire. We don't know. I don't know the chemical properties of propofol, do you guys? I mean, it could have caught on fire in a minute. I don't know, but it's a reality. So we had to take the equipment with us, and I did a video on that because I think people need to stand their ground. If you're in the right, you're the last link in the chain. And you need to stand your ground on something. It could be somebody that way outranks you. Sometimes you just gotta draw a line in the sand and be like, I'm willing to risk my job over this moment right here. And I did a video about that saying, guys, if the patient, if their life is in danger and nobody else cares, you have to be the one. Well, anyway, a doctor seen that video. They contacted my HR department and they tried to get me fired. It's true. But I did it in my car. I didn't do it on the clock. I did it in the car in front of my house. I didn't have my badge showing, no nothing. They looked me up on LinkedIn, they found out who I worked for, and they tried to get me fired. It's gonna happen. This is cancel culture, guys. Just be wary that anything you say can and probably will be used against you. I've been bit twice. So, in closing, guys, social media is the future. I highly encourage you guys to join online biomed groups, participate in the forums, help people find jobs. There are a lot of people out there that are looking for jobs. If you know of an opening in your facility, just say, hey, man, I might be able to get you a hookup. Answer student questions about biomed. These guys are very curious and they're very hungry. You got a lot of engineering students. A lot of them are really bright. They have no idea what we do. And all you got to do is get on there and try answering some of their questions. Find interns looking for opportunities. These guys are out there too, they're at your colleges. If you guys have never stopped by a college and talked to some of the students, it would be a good opportunity. You know, it's good for the soul, it really is, because you see these people that are hungry, they just want an opportunity, just give them a moment of your time. Make videos of severe equipment failures. I am so adamant about this one, because guys, if you have a catastrophic failure in one of your devices, it's gonna happen in another unit. So what I do is if I have a problem, like something completely falls apart, you get a loose part, a wire caught fire, something like that, take care of the problem, but check the rest of your inventory, or at least check a percentage of your inventory, because if it happens to one, it's gonna happen to others. And that's why I say share it on social media, because if it's happening to your equipment, it's probably happening to yours. I mean, that's the way it is. And if we all were proactive like that, we could probably nip a lot of these problems in the bud before it blows up and you know you're put on the line. And share best practices, guys. This is such a big one. I mean, if you guys are doing something really well in your shop, please share it, because some people have no idea how to run a shop. It's true, we've all seen it. And everybody does something well. If you guys do something well, post it out there on one of the forums, say, hey, you know, y'all might have this problem, but we do it this way, and it's worked out fantastic for us. That's all I have for you guys.
Questions? Here we go. I got one for you.
Sure, go ahead, man.
My first one is, what is right to repair?
Oh, that's a good one. Guys, there are some major developments in right to repair recently. So, if you guys didn't know, Avante was kind of heading this up. They're a huge, huge company. They specialize in x-ray equipment, but they do other things. And right to repair is basically the people pushing back. You know, we got devices like your cell phones and whatnot. They're purposely making it so if you change a part on that component, that it no longer will function. Well, that's anti-competitive behavior. So right to repair is actual legislation, and right now it's going on in a vast majority of your states in some capacity. Texas is included in them, and some of them are really pushing it forward. There is one for automotive that passed in Massachusetts, but over the next couple of years, check it out. I think it's repair.org, and you'll see up-to-the-minute legislation. Anyway, Avante, they were fighting the good fight for us for a while, and they, as of last week or the week before, one of their guys called me up, one of their head ups, and said, hey man, we just won our court case. And I was super excited because what their court case was about, they developed their own tools to access like equipment keys to get in and service it. You know, a lot of x-ray equipment, they have service keys, they're only good for 24 hours or 48 hours or whatever. That's complete garbage. But they reverse engineered the software and they came up with their own keys to be able to do it. And they have a variety of tools that allow them to calibrate equipment and stuff. They have a whole R&D department. They got sued because they reverse engineered the software. But the court case came out and what they said is that, guys, if you own a device, you have the right to get in there and maintain your equipment. That was the court decision. And if I think for the next couple of years, they can't even appeal that. So as it's current, they're off in the clear. They can engineer stuff, which opens the door for other people. So if you have a device, let's say that you need to maintain it, but you don't have the code to get into service mode. Well, now we can reverse engineer it. We can get in there. We can do whatever we got. And now we have precedence to do that. It's an excellent thing. Good question, man. Right to repair is a political movement for you to be able to maintain your equipment. It's a non-competitive behavior, the flat rate repairs, all the stuff that OEMs have been doing to us lately, it's starting to change and it's giving us options. So, any other questions, guys?
Here's my second question.
Sure.
You use the words nice and easy as far as how you would want to either show somebody to do maybe a PM or repair.
Okay, sure.
You're from, you know, almost 20 years of doing this, and I'm sure there's people that have more time. What I've seen in the short amount of time that I've been in Biomed, I've been a welder for over 25 years, and I left that to come here. Not my choice, because the place shut down. And what I've noticed, a few people, old school people maybe, their mentality is just go learn, go do it. I'm not gonna show you, but figure it out. But the way I learn is the video, is somebody talking to me, somebody showing me, not just go and do it, you know, figure it out.
That's exactly right. If I give you a book, I can expect you to take a half hour to 45 minutes at least, if it's not that complex of a procedure, to figure it out. You have a Biomed want a book and, you know, maybe a 45 minute long PM, they're gonna take 2.5 hours, maybe longer. Does that really make sense? Like I said, we have to do more with less. It's not an option anymore. And the thing is, I can show them how to, I don't show anybody how to do PMs in any of my videos, because PMs change, guys. You could have recalls, you know, software revisions, anything could happen. I won't show PMs, but I will show you how the technology works. I'll show you physiology, anatomy, stuff like that, because that's the stuff that is really important. The other important thing that I try to focus on is showing people how to troubleshoot, you know, and I've started doing some more of those videos, but the thing is I can show you the technology. You can learn that in a book. I can't teach you from a book how to troubleshoot something. It's a skill that it takes time and it takes mentorship. And that's why things like the electricians and whatnot, they do the journeyman system, because you're next to them, you're learning. And Biomeds don't really have that. In the military, we do. In the military, there's kind of this structure and training plan, but in the civilian side, they're thrown to the wolves. And I don't think that's the right answer. So I do say nice and easy because it doesn't have to be complex. If I'm doing a PM and you know you want to see how to set up the analyzer and do the PM, you should be following the book. But if you need to quickly learn how to set up the analyzer or what the device does, I mean, think about a defib. If I were to tell you about a defib, I'm going to tell you about the clinical applications, like the regulations about like how many milliseconds cardiosync should be. There's a lot of things that are, go along with a defib PM, but I want to make sure that you know every aspect of it. That stuff can be recorded. Now, verbatim PMs, no. You should always be following your checklist and stuff like that. But nice and easy, a lot of stuff we do, people don't know. And it's a nice and easy video. You're gonna do it anyway, right? Just pop up a camera and show. Nice and easy, that's why I said it. Any other questions? Sure.
Where can we get those batteries that you were talking about?
The batteries, man, I'll tell you what. Well, guys, so it is gonna be serious. So we already face it with microchips, lead acid batteries. That's a public service announcement that shortage is gonna happen. So we do keep them in stock at FOBI, but even that's a limited supply, guys. So we're gonna buy them as much as we can, but when it's up, it's up. We're all in the same boat. So, but we do keep them on stock, and we keep some unusual batteries. I was going through their parts inventories. They're thinking I was a weirdo because I'm going through all the little bins and stuff they got. There's like fat coin cell batteries and stuff. You know, some really special batteries. I never would have thought FOBI had it. They've got it. It's the craziest thing. Any other questions, guys? Sure, what you got?
I have a best practice. I was supporting a go live the other day,
okay.
And the physician was so delighted because he could get his orders into his modality and do his exam. Another physician couldn't then see his images on the system. Well, so we were doing some telephone troubleshooting with me there and the Biomed on remote. But the best practice is you've got some of these little quick videos that you can actually embed into your EMR. So when you have a problem, something you click on that little video, it shows you real quick. These are the screens that you're looking for, so they can go find your images.
Oh, that's really cool. So stuff like that, I would love to capture on video because when that happens, when you notice that that's a capability, other people probably wish it was a capability too.
Well,
you know.
We have the vendor to do those videos for us, and so the ones that are like 3 minutes or less, we embed it into the EMR, and the longer ones are in our MH universities.
Okay. Well, that's interesting. EMR, you know, Biomeds are starting to work more and more on EMR stuff. And there's a lot of stuff that people should know. You know, it's getting more complex. You know, they call it the Internet of Things, and more devices are interfacing with the Internet. And yeah, how you program those little modules and stuff, that should all be recorded. That way there, you don't spend and waste all this time training another person, another person, another person. You can just say, here's like the binder, go to this page, or here's a link on an email, just go do this.
Yeah, because that's what we were finding is that you know, each different hospital had different wireless modalities, and they all had to, you know, some of them were this vendor, some of that vendor, and some of this software. Okay. So if you just do one or two videos and say, okay, this is all the stuff that you need to make sure
yeah.
The modalities are working.
It's nice and easy. That's what I say. I mean, you're doing a lot of it anyway. Might as well just record it for posterity, you know, for the people that are gonna come after you. So, yeah, what's up?
I just had a comment. It was kind of like about me, but probably applies to some other people. You probably, like you showed me that Discord app, and I didn't really understand it at first. I forgot I had it on the phone. I looked at it for a while, and I just like looked at it and had it update. And I was like, I probably need to spend more time figuring out some of that stuff because I looked at it and I forgot about it. You go, oh yeah, you did show me that. And
that's the thing about all these tools is once you get in the habit of using them. Like you're gonna find out, it's gonna change the way you do business. Things are gonna be happening faster. You know, people, your network's gonna grow bigger. Like people are gonna be like, oh yeah, you're that guy that was commenting on stuff. And you know, when that happens, you know, you solve problems together faster. I mean, I'm only so smart, you guys are only so smart, but together, we can solve some problems.
And another observation about me personally, maybe I'm like more old school. Like if I'm working on something, if I want to figure something out, I still like looking at, like I'll look at videos, but I'm too impatient inherently. So I don't want to, you know, and if I try to fast forward it, I'll miss it. I'll always try to find like something with pictures, and I'll try to skim through it. And a lot of times I can, like if I'm working something, I can find it quicker. if I can't find it that way, then I go to video. So I don't know, maybe I should use videos more.
Videos they're such an awesome use because you can see exactly how it happens. Pictures are good for things like circuit diagrams or layouts or something like that, but video, I mean, there's a lot that a video says about what you're doing. I mean, you can tell the person's confidence, you can see shortcuts. There's a lot of stuff that people do while they're doing a PM that actually cut a lot of time off, you know?
I use it a lot for like the trick, even on a wiper blade, I figured out that I can get the stuff like, dang, how difficult could this be? And I never realized you have to move it forward and flip it a certain way, and I was like, man, you know, I could have probably spent an hour and moved that thing. The only way that you have to move it to get the thing.
Well, if I have a device that I'm getting a work order for that I've never heard of before, I promise you, I look it up before I set foot in the door. I promise you, every time. I'll first go to YouTube to see how they set it up or whatnot. Because if they say like a motor's not running or something like that, I look to see how somebody sets it up. Gives me some sort of concept of what I should expect when I walk in. And then from there, you know, your confidence will carry you through the problem, right? So, anyway, guys,
I'm not cutting you off. I'm just standing.
No, that's cool, man. That's cool, because I will run on if you guys let me. Yes, sir.
I'd like to just make a comment to, what's your name?
Lewis.
That statement that you brought up is a pet peeve of mine, and my name is Joe Boone. I hate that. Anybody that's hoarding information from you and don't want to show you the correct way, that person needs to communicate with your leadership on that and that person, because that's the same thing with the right to repair.
Right.
The right for you to know how to do something appropriate in this field. Because what we do is safe clinical application operation of medical devices. And if nobody's willing to show you the correct way, I got a problem with that. So you bring that up to your leadership, because we shouldn't be hoarding information. That's the purpose of HTM.
Yep.
That's the purpose of every Biomed Society out there, to come and collaborate and then come and share our knowledge. That's what we're fighting against with the OEMs now. The right to repair our equipment. The right for you to know you're in this field. If they're not sharing with you, take it up to your leadership.
You guys know that that's the number one complaint that I hear. I talk to hundreds of biomeds. That's the number one complaint that I hear in every single state, every single shop, is that people hoard information. Guys, I'll tell you every single secret I got. I don't even care, because the thing is that there's people that have to come up after you. And people that think if you hoard information because you want to be the guy, well, guess what? The guy has a heart attack one day. The guy decides that he got a divorce and he's going to move away. I've seen almost everything you can think of, and it left a hole in the system. And when you have a hole, it hurts us all. You know, not only does it break up the team, but you have a hole of information, and now we are all left like chickens with our heads cut off trying to solve the problem that should have been solved already. People need to share information. It's the number one complaint for all biomeds, is that nobody's sharing information.
Once again, give a hand for this.
This is such an excellent opportunity, man.
And just to go off on some of the stuff that Justin said, Lin Ken, had to go raise my hand, do a couple depositions for medical equipment issues that happened. The lawyer looked me up on LinkedIn. But there was nothing out there. As it says, don't put it out there. She went out there, and I was like, to myself when she's asking questions, she goes, oh, I noticed on your LinkedIn account, da da da. And I'm saying to myself, like, hell, what did that have to do with this case? But they go look. So they're looking for stuff on that. Sharing information, best practice. Rafi here, MD Anderson. DMV came to my, well, first they went to St. Luke's, then they went to their house, then they came to my house. We were on the phone talking. Hey, what are you looking for? We shared that information with St. Luke's, MD Anderson, and then Taub. We were sharing that information so we knew what the, not everything, but we, okay, go look for this. Make sure this is in order. That's the key thing he says. Don't just let the leadership do it at that level. You guys do it at the technician level too. You got friends working in all the hospitals. Share that. Share that knowledge on those things. I will tell you this, I'm 58, I'm my former age. I was looking at retiring at 62. I really like what I'm hearing. I want to be part of more, and I'll admit, using YouTube, I use it in my personal life. how to change the light board in my Dodge Ram, how to get to that light bulb in there, how to take 110 off with the blow dryer so you don't have to pay the guy. My dialysis guys is back there. One Saturday, I get a call because our XL Phoenix meter, the staff over there, they had a hydro meter in the Phoenix, and they didn't know how to use the Phoenix meter. And at the time, I couldn't get a hold of my own call guy. I wasn't a Dodge call guy that weekend. So I said, all right, I'm going over there. And I get there, swear to God, I'm in my truck. What do? YouTube. I sat in my truck for maybe 10 minutes, watched that video twice. I went in there, they never knew that.
That's right. That's all that matters.
Never knew that. When I went in there, I was the subject matter expert. And then when I got done, I said, let me show you, in case you forget anything we just went over, let me show you a YouTube video you can watch and pull up and you can just know how to do this. And they thought that was the best thing since sliced bread. And they'll tell you, I had never even opened a box on the XL Phoenix meter on doing dialysis, doing the water testing. But within that 10 minutes, I was a subject matter expert on how to use that meter. So that's why when I started watching some of your videos and the different stuff, and we talked about getting you to come, I said, yeah, this needs to spark all of us. Because the information is out there. It is out there, it's especially learning. And I'm going to use Joe Boone because he did some clinicals, learned a lot of clinical stuff. So when he works with the guys with the DFibs, he goes in the clinical, and we did that in the military, in the biomed school. You learn some of the clinical part because you need to know that how equipment works, you know, as far as the doctor, where they're looking for nursing, so you understand what you're doing on it. So that's a big play, but definitely become part of this. And I'll admit, I'm not part of a lot of the switch meetings, but listen to this, yeah, it's time to definitely step it up. And even my new guys that I have coming into the field and guys that's been in the field, we got to start using this and sharing that knowledge. Definitely powerful. Great. Yeah, Fobi, you did right on that one. Sorry, Marm, but yeah, they did right on that, definitely. All right, so a couple things. New people to the group, to the team. Just